Mr. Rakesh Khanna. No relationship, sorry. He is the president of the Supreme Court Bar Association, and I've been told that his name is enough. So, no other introduction is required. So, please, Mr. Khanna, thank you. He's also a very dear friend of the family and has been associated with the Gogna family and the trust for many years. Thank you.
Just like, you know, because of the judgment, sir has delivered like an independent thought. The society has already made a book like, you know, this entire judgment. And, so this independent thought, they have made a, like, you know, entire judgment as copy, 1,000 copies and raised you. I gave you.
Family members of Mr. R.Gogna. My esteemed brother and sister colleagues at bar, ladies and gentlemen. When I was looking into the brief history of Mr. R.Gogna, I find he is a first generation lawyer and has risen from scratch. With no background of law, he has entered the field and reached the pinnacle. I find the genes in both the children, Rajesh ji as well as Jyotika ji, very fine lawyers, very polite, but always very well prepared. Highly intellectual and humble. I'm grateful that I'm invited to this discussion. And when I was given the topic, and Jyotika ji told me, this is a topic which she has taken from a book of my Lord Justice Krishna Iyer. For a minute I was really under pressure. Whether I'll be able to justify even my talk to such a great jurist which India had. Many of you might not be knowing Justice Krishna Iyer, before he became judge, was a politician. He was a minister also in Kerala, and he had, if I'm not wrong, he had even gone to jail in one of the political movements. And in fact, once I was talking to Chief Justice Thakur, when we were discussing about the collegium system, and I asked His Lordship, I said, will the today's collegium would have recommended the name of Justice Krishna Iyer? And His Lordship's categorical reply was no. Be that as it may, this topic, law, society, and collective consciousness, is perhaps one of the three important aspects of one's life or a life of a society. Any society . The stature of the society is known. How orderly is the conduct and behavior of its citizens? Law, if I go for this topic, in my understanding, saying is best defined by Austin in his theory of law, where he says law is nothing but will of the people. And I'll come back to this when I elaborate on this. Of course, I am not the keynote speaker, but I am just trying to do some groundwork. And I think I will not be attached to what this is locally speaking, but I am doing little effort. Law, as I see jurisprudentially, in our ancient legal system, especially in India, we have been calling this as dharma. Many people will think that dharma is nothing but religion. No. Dharma, according to Indian jurisprudence, has been treated as synonym of law. Essentially, the nature, that is, law, will constitute one of the part of the dharma. Because dharma, broadly speaking, is treated as a way of life, is also treated by the religion. But according to Jaimini, one of the Indian ancient, I may call him jurist, dharma is founded on revelation, which is conducive to welfare of society. That was the concept Jaimini had in mind when he conceived the concept of dharma. According to Manusmriti, conduct is the basis of dharma, and it is not what you think, but what you do constitutes your dharma. And Manusmriti says the basic concept of a society, an Indian society, which constitutes the basis of the dharma, is non-violence. That is the essence of dharma. As I said, dharma, when we talk, it talks of religion and law. But according to me, they are only two facets. Basically, dharma is the basic way of life which is contemplated that in the prevailing rules and orders, how an individual in a society has to conduct himself. When I look at other jurisprudences, then maybe it is called hukam in Islamic system and Romans call it jus. And in Germany and France they call it rigid and droit. When I look at what Max Muller says, he says the moral order of righteousness derived from the order of heavenly movement came to be named as laws, which the society was ordained to follow scrupulously. Again, wherever I see, this is law is a concept which has been developed for ordained way of conduct of an individual of the society. Now in this context, when I look at what Austin said, that law is the will of the people. Therefore, the law becomes an instrument of not only the conduct of an individual in the society, but also social transformation to regulate the collective consciousness of the society. This is how the three concepts of law, society, and collective consciousness get correlated. This is how they are interwoven by the golden thread and they are correlated. Secondly, if I say the collective consciousness need to be regulated with the instrument of law to achieve the goal of welfare of the society. Again, this is a concept how law, society, and collective consciousness get intertwined. And when I look at rivers, in the Austin's theory of law is will of people, then collective consciousness may require the society to frame newer laws to meet the emerging situations and requirements of the society. So this is how, you see, law regulates and then how collective consciousness regulates things. They become interdependent. Let me try to explain when I say law is an important instrument of social transformation. Taking clue from what my Lord has in the environmental law have gone into. Now, environmental law has developed here in India when out of collective consciousness and the demand of the society that the pollution is being caused and how to regulate it, the government formed laws in the 70s, late 70s. Then came the environment protection laws subsequently after a decade. But how these laws were not able to tackle the problem and how our Honorable Supreme Court had to come to meet the demand of collective consciousness. When the Supreme Court, in the matter of dealing with air quality in Delhi, had to come with the direction that the diesel commercial vehicles, especially taxis and autos, will be banned in Delhi. And each one of us had seen this direction of the Supreme Court not only had come to the aid of the society and responded to the requirement of collective consciousness. We have been able to breathe in Delhi. Of course, of late, again, because of different reasons, the pollution is growing. But imagine those 3 lakh vehicles which went off the diesel, if they were also on the road, Delhi would have been more than a gas chamber. The requirement of meeting pollution by solid waste management, air noise pollution, water pollution, discharge of industrial effluents. Again, Supreme Court had ordered in Delhi that each industrial area will have its own effluent treatment plants. Many of you may be knowing or may not be knowing. In every area, industrial area in Delhi, so under the directions of the Supreme Court, specific effluent treatment plants have been installed to deal with the pollution, water pollution. Another angle, let us see when the concept of life under Article 21 has been expanded by the Honorable Supreme Court. to meet the demand of the society. And added to the concept right to shelter, right to livelihood, right to education, right to food, responding to this, especially let me go to education sector, the parliament came up with Article 21A, providing free education between up to class 8. Then the government came out with Right to Education Act, again to meet the demand of the lower strata and the have-nots by providing 25% seats in all educational institutions by way of free education. If I see, this is how the laws have evolved to meet the requirement of the society and demand of collective consciousness. This is a concept where law, which is made for the society, then comes the response, that is the collective response of the society, again going into the same circle, going back to the demand of the society and leading to formation of new laws. So this whole circle completes, and this is how these three concepts get correlated. In my understanding, therefore, these three concepts are like, when I look into the Kelsen's theory of jurisprudence, are basically the groomed norms of a society. The other laws, codified laws, groomed norms are never codified laws. The other laws are the norms which evolve for meeting the exigency, for meeting the demand, or because of the demand of collective consciousness. So this concept of law, society and collective consciousness, they are interwoven, and they respond to each other to meet and to develop a better society for tomorrow. Thank you very much.
I think you must have been a good student of jurisprudence. In Delhi University, everyone finds that the toughest subject. But you really go through the law. And very rightfully, you have said that law is so good to people, like Austin said. And the Indian Parliament is a living example of that. Because janta ki pratinidhi hai, wo baithi hai, aur wo hi jo janta chahti hai, uske anusar. Another issue which you spoke about on dharma, not dharma, but jaise Buddha ne kaha tha dhamma, D-H-A-M-M-A, fourfold Buddha ka fourfold path tha. So basically, what is it? It's how for the welfare of society to regulate your conduct. Simple. Or collective consciousness and law ki baat jahan tak aapne ki, isse behtar Delhi wale I think से कौन ज़्यादा जानेगा क्योंकि जब निर्भय कांड हुआ था ये जनता में आक्रोश था एक collective consciousness जो रोज अत्याचार महिलाओं के विरुद्ध हो रहे हैं हम उसको नजरअंदाज कर देते थे लेकिन उस वाक्य उस incident के बाद सारी जनता में इतना आक्रोश था कि सरकार को कानून बनानी पड़ी वो अलग बात है वो implement हुई कि नहीं वो एक अलग ही issue है so thank you very much for your illuminating speech